Hello and welcome to the Tillage Edge with me, Michael Hennessy. This is your regular update for all your tillage news and advice. As the harvest rumbles on this week, I'm sure everyone in the industry is reveling in the sunny weather and the excellent progress of the harvest. There are many areas of the country which will largely be finished harvesting in about a week or so. Looking across the water to the UK, the weather they have endured has probably been drier and definitely hotter than Ireland this year. So I'm delighted to be joined by Andy Mann, who's a farm manager in North Bedfordshire, which is in the heart of England's arable area. Andy runs a large estate with a no-till establishment system on heavy clay soils and strives to grow a mix of crops, but winter wheat is the bedrock of the system. Andy, you're very welcome to the podcast. Andy, it's been a while since we've spoken, and I'm sure you're in the middle of harvest at the moment. So you might just give listeners an update about your winter and spring crops and how they looked going into May.
We've got mainly winter wheat. We had a few winter beans, which I drilled far too late into November, late November, and they just didn't survive. It got quite wet around Christmas, and the crows and pigeons had most of those. So we didn't really have a lot of winter beans coming forward. Ground was well set up for spring crops. We had some good cover crops in. Coming into early spring, we did our spring drilling probably earlier than usual, probably maybe the third week of March we started. We added 70 hectares of spring wheat and 70 hectares of spring oats and a little bit of contracting as well. We undersowed the spring wheat with clover, white clover, which was sort of reasonably successful. But since we've hit this drought conditions, we're just cutting the spring wheat today, actually, and I can't see much clover under there now, unfortunately. I think it's probably disappeared down the cracks, unfortunately. But it's been a pretty regular spring, but the alarm bells were, I suppose if they are alarm bells, but knew something was up when we started to see, normally we'd see flag leaf emergence, or we'd be planning to do flag leaf sort of full emergence sprays anytime from the 17th to the 20th of May. We were more likely the 7th to the 10th of May, so we were a good 10 days earlier. At that point, I thought, hang on, I've never, ever seen that before. That was quite unusual. And disease pressure wasn't particularly high. We were doing work with Corteva and stuff, and Bayer doing rapid testing for Septoria and yellow rust, and not really seeing high levels of either disease, really. We just did depending on what variety, we sort of choose the fungicide program to suit the varieties. It was a pretty regular. My main concern was it was quite cold, not frosty cold, but just, all through late May, early June, we didn't see much sunshine. It was quite cloudy. It was cold. You needed a jacket on in the early part of the day. And then suddenly, middle of June, end of June, I suppose, the sun came out and it's been hot ever since, really.
Andy, by the time you got to May, I presume it was relatively dry in your part of the world. You were drier than you normally would have been, as in you were really, wanting water at that stage, maybe. That the way it was?
Yeah. We were getting rain, but not big amounts. We were getting sort of, 5 mil here, 5 mil there sort of thing. Not huge. We weren't getting sort of 20 mil of rain anywhere. It was fairly steady.
And from May all the way through, then I would presume you got about the same, very little either, I think.
Very little. I mean, we've had, we had sort of 13 mil of rain in April, 37 mil of rain in May, 29 mil in June. And most of that 29 mil fell on the 5th of June in one night. We had a good long 24 hours of rain. And since then, really, we had 12 mil of rain on the 1st of July, and we haven't really had a lot since that, if I'm honest. So it's not been, for the spring crops particularly, they haven't had a lot of rainfall on them. They've had sort of not much more than sort of 70 mil of rain on them from planting to harvest. So, it's been a tough year for them, to be fair.
Yeah. And going back, because you just remind listeners, your establishment system is based around kind of a no-till type scenario. And I suppose within those systems or within that kind of system, the hope is certainly coming from maybe other countries that it would preserve moisture a little bit better maybe than a more open or a more conventional type system. Are you seeing anything coming through in your system, or are you in it long enough, do you think, that might be slightly different than your neighbours who are in a plough-based system?
Yeah, there's no doubt. Anybody who cultivated, they lost all the moisture, particularly guys were cultivating in sort of late March there. And whereas we definitely preserved any moisture that was there, we did preserve. And our crops get away quite well in the spring. I think we're seeing the benefit of that. But regardless of the system, that's just not enough rainfall, really, to be honest, to get you all the way through to harvest. So yields haven't been overly special on the spring stuff. But yeah, I mean, the winter crops rooted well and held on well. But again, the cracks opened up and, it was just, I think, we definitely lost a bit of yield. It was so dry and early to harvest as well. The growing season was that bit shorter. We always talk about trying to keep the greening and keep them green for longer, but you just couldn't stop it. It was so hot here that they just burnt off, sort of thing. So,
and you mentioned the disease levels were relatively low on lots of your crops, and you were tailoring anyway. Have you had the opportunity to make a reasonable saving on your fungicide programs this year?
Yeah, we definitely have. Yeah, I mean, I've been sort of experimenting quite a bit. We grew a mixture of Theodore and Costello, so quite good disease resistance out of those two. I grew 40 hectares of that, and we had various different treatments in that. And there's no doubt we did put a flag leaf fungicide. We did a sort of T1 fungicide and then a flag leaf fungicide, and with just the flag leaf fungicide. And I think the fungicide did bring something to the party there, but not huge amounts. So most of our varieties have been pretty good. We grow Crusoe, we've had SY in Sator as well, which has really surprised me. That's been a great variety. X-Tay is probably not so much this year for us, but so we're not growing a high risk variety. So there is a chance we don't tend to do anything at growth stage 30. See how we're at growth stage 32. And I think there's some good fungicides about at growth stage 37, even in the absence of disease, the likes of Inatrek and stuff. I've seen good yield response to Inatrek, even in a dry year sort of thing. So I'm fairly convinced to use that. And then, I don't tend to do an ear wash necessarily on feed wheats. Milling wheats we would do, particularly with Crusoe, because brown rust can be a problem at that time of year. So yeah, we'd get a tebuconazole on that.
And we mentioned, Andy, before around kind of weeds within the system. I suppose grass weeds can often be a little bit of a problem. Are you slightly better this year with them, or are more of them coming through, or what way are you coping this year with them?
Some and some, really. I was still 2018, where we didn't get any autumn drilling done, is still sort of quite forefront of my mind, particularly last year, and we started drilling quite early. Where I thought we were reasonably clean, we were drilling after spring oats and put quite a chunk of Crusoe in, and God, that was hooching with black grass. I was kind of committed to growing it on contract, and I thought I'd get away with it, but that we definitely saw a yield penalty for the amount of black grass we had in there. I reckon we probably lost a ton of hectare because of that black grass. Yeah, in places you can see on the yield map. So you can tell where we started drilling early, and as we got later and later, the SY Intertour we drilled last sort of mid-October, end of October, that was definitely the cleanest of it. But the establishment wasn't quite as good, so there's a trade-off there as well. So, I guess the optimum drilling date for us it would be the probably first week of October sometime. 7th to the 15th of October is probably the optimum drilling time for us. But obviously, I can't drill the whole farm in a week. It takes us sort of, 2.5-3 weeks. So we have to sort of start either side of that. And that was reflected, I think, in the crops and the yield as well, actually. So.
And for the early zone ones, Andy, just in terms of that weed control, was it that the pre-emerge herbicides didn't work as well, or is it just down to pressure?
I think probably a bit of both, Michael. There was a lot of black grass pressure there. It was dry prior to drilling, so we didn't get much of a flush of black grass. And there was a fairish mat of straw there after the oats as well. We ended up, my first choice would have been to drill that with a tine drill, but we just couldn't get the tine drill through the trash. The straw was just the oats were quite green. The straw was quite green. The oats were you know, dry when we cut them, but the straw was quite green, and there was we had to drill with a disc drill to get through it. And I don't think that perhaps got away quite as well. There was a thick mat of straw, and I don't know if the black grass herbicides, the pre-em herbicides, worked quite as well, because there was such a mat of straw there that I don't know if they were binding to the soil quite as well and creating that chemical layer. So they definitely did have control, but perhaps not as good as we've seen in the past. So I think there's a whole combination of factors at play, actually. There's, you know, there's the trash, the dry spell as well, and it was quite, you know, it was reasonably good drilling conditions when we were drilling. It was going in nice, it was a bit of soil moisture, but it was just very dry on top. And I think actually a drop of rain when we were drilling might have helped those pre-ems work a little bit better as well.
Okay. Yeah. It's often difficult to get it all right. As you say, you're betwixt and between getting it in and but then getting weed control done properly is often difficult.
Exactly.
In terms of harvest, you mentioned, Andy, that crops were earlier to get to flag leaf and presumably to head out as well. So I presume your harvest has started a bit earlier then as well, is it?
Yeah, I mean, we'll be the 9th of August today. It's our last day. We're just cutting the spring wheat today. So I don't know if we'll quite finish it tonight. There won't be a lot left tomorrow. It'll only be literally a couple of hours tomorrow to finish if we don't get it all this evening. But yeah, I've never known a harvest like it. We've started probably 10 days ago on the Friday. I can't think what day that was now. And yeah, we haven't stopped. Everything's been dry. I haven't hardly touched the moisture meter. The combine monitors the moisture for us, but I've never, you know, I just haven't. We've just started first thing in the morning. As soon as we dieseled up, we're going. There's been no dew. I've never had a run straight through harvest like this, where we have not had no stoppages at all. We just, and you know, 10 days and we're virtually done. In fact, we had a day off on Sunday because we were so ahead of the game and the forecast was good for this week. I said to the lads, we might as well have a day off. So yeah, it's all dry.
You must be thinking to yourself, is that like, see if you have to move into France or something? That's what they must feel like. Exactly.
Well, ironically, actually, I was in France and on holidays, and I started to feel very guilty. So we came home early, and I have said that it must be what it's like for the guys in sort of south of Paris there, that, you know, every day is a good harvesting day, and you just do it at your leisure sort of thing. You know, it's no wonder the French lads are so relaxed. But yeah, it's been the easiest harvest I've ever known and the earliest. But, you know, we'd normally be just about starting about now, about the 9th, 10th of August. We'd be, you know, anytime now, we'd be ready to be, you know, testing it and getting ready to start sort of thing. But yeah, to be finished. And most lads around here are virtually finished now or got it in a corner. They're just taking the time now just to finish off. So,
okay.
Yeah.
And obviously that comes with a bit of a cost, I suppose, on the other side in terms of yields. Are they lower than your expectations, do you think?
Yeah, I reckon we're probably 10% down. We had a great year last year, really good yields last year. Our yields were probably 10% down on our long-term average so this year. And I think it's there's no doubt the dry weather's had an effect. We haven't had that much first wheat this year because our rotation got kind of mucked up with a lack of beans and stuff in there. Sort of going back to 2018, we didn't get any winter crops, and we've had spring crop heavily the last 2 years to try and get things back on track again. So I think this autumn we'll be back more with more first wheat and stuff, and that should bring us back. I think that was definitely a lack of break crops. Putting winter wheat in after spring is just not ideal. I've learned that. So yeah, I think hopefully we'll be back on track again this autumn. So yeah, yields are definitely, a bushel weight have been very good. I haven't had any proteins back yet, but bushel weights are very good. We're up in the 80s on most of it. And you know, yields are not disastrous, and the price will certainly make up, you know. Crops that we're harvesting now are all bought with the sort of, I don't want to say cheap fertilizer, but cheaper fertilizer than I've currently got in the shed. And you know, inputs were cheaper. We're very much a low input, you know, low output system. I'm not chasing that 12 ton a hectare or something. So
And did you have that slightly lower yield? Does it mean that your protein, do you hope, is going to be up that little bit more and more of it to make the milling?
Yeah, I hope so. I mean, we grow milling on contract to Warburton. Matt was telling me all through the season we were bang on. So, and you know, flag leaf onwards, we did quite a lot of testing with that, and it was all showing, you know, that we were bang on for protein for Crusoe. So I don't know how accurate they are, but yeah, it'll be interesting to see. The grain's got a good colour to it. So yeah, fingers crossed. I mean, one change I have instigated, we're updating our drill. So we run a Horizon, our prime drill is a Horizon disc drill. We've got an old horse CO8 that we use as well. But our prime drill that we use is a Horizon disc drill. That's updated. Unfortunately, it's slightly delayed, but we're going to put a liquid fertilizer system on that as well. So we will be able to put stuff down at planting, not necessarily, you know, your traditional NPK, but maybe other things that might help with establishment as well. So I think that's one positive step forward. I think we'll be drilling into, obviously we've got more winter beans this year, not great crop, but the ground will be a bit cleaner there. And where the beans failed, I planted quite a decent summer cover crop with a lot of legumes in it. So again, that should give us some nice, decent ground to go at this autumn drilling. So my big worry is when this drought breaks that it'll start to rain and not stop. So yep. Again, it's going to be that balance as we get towards, you know, middle of September. When do we, you know, sort of pull the trigger and start drilling? And you know, I'll be keeping a close eye on the forecast and sort of, you know, we'll be ready to go. So yeah, so I think, yeah, like I said, I don't know yet whether we'll have that drill with the option to put liquid fert and stuff down at drilling. I think that'll make a big difference to us, although it's slightly flexing the rules a little bit on MVZs, but I think that will help being able to put amendments down at the seed. I think rather than just relying on seed coatings or seed dressings, being able to put some biology or some other bits down with the drill will help establishment. Okay. So
I haven't heard you mention oilseed rape at all as yet. I presume in the past there might have been oilseed rape. Is oilseed rape a no-no in your area, on your farm?
I've got one neighbour who grows rape still. There's not much in our area, mainly flea beetle. For us, it's never been a great crop in terms of pigeons. We've got an awful lot of woodland dotted around the farm, a lot of trees. And, you know, we were shooting probably 3,000 to 4,000 pigeons a season. It's a full-time job virtually scaring pigeons off oilseed rape for us. So being as we've had a restriction arm on my own, we don't have the labour to do that. And flea beetle's a big issue. There's been some fantastic rape yields that I've heard of over here this year, real good yields. Anybody that had a good crop will have done very well. The general feeling is that there's probably not going to be huge flea beetle pressure this year because it hasn't been seen at harvest. So in the trailers coming in. So I think there'll be a fair bit. Mind you, it's so dry here. Nobody's talking about drilling any rape at the moment. I think there's maybe a chance of some rain next week, but depending on how much we get, that will probably influence how much people plant, I think.
So your break crop then, Andy, is beans, I suppose, for the most part, and oats then, is it? Or do you have anything else that you can bring in?
Well, beans and oats. And then I've got a dairy farm down the road that I've been growing sort of clover, red clover and grass for him. So that acts as I'll be planting wheat into that this autumn. So that's been quite a good break. And that works well for both of us, I think. Helps him out because he hasn't got enough ground to grow forage on. He wants it for grazing and he wants to, you know, grow his forage with us or with other people. And so yeah, that works quite well. That's a nice little break crop as well.
Nice. Very good. And is there any muck involved in that in terms of organic manures coming back onto your
I'm working on it. Right. He's That's got a straw one. For muck deal with another neighbour, and I think, yeah, we're working on it. That would be what I would be very keen to get some more from if I can.
Okay, you mentioned earlier the relatively cheap cost of fertilizers to grow crops this year. How do you view next year? Are you going to implement some changes due to the very high costs and I suppose, really, have you bought any fertilizer as well as being the starting point for that?
Starting point is, yeah, I've bought all my fertilizer. I just sort of kept an eye on it. We've been, when the Ukraine invasion happened, I bought, we've got a fairly big diesel tank and I filled that. We've got a 20,000 litre diesel tank, so I filled that. So we bought a diesel, which has got us mostly through the season. I had to buy another 10,000 recently just to get us through harvest. But so our inputs have been great this year. But yeah, it's been a bit of a shock. There was a lot of guys panic bought fertilizer back in March for next season. They were paying, you know, there was some big prices being talked around over here. But I've bought a mixture of urea, ammonium sulfate, and some liquid as well. And I'm pretty much double what I paid last year for everything. So my fertilizer bill is about double what it was last year, but I know it could have been worse, and I don't think could have been a lot better. But yeah, at one point there was talk about no supply at all, like there might not be any fertilizer about. So we're looking at trying to boost the nitrogen use efficiency. I think anybody should be doing that anyway, but we're using sort of, you know, trying to be more canny. That's why I was using the N tester and things like that to just try and tailor the nitrogen use to the crop, if you like. And I partly wonder if we're not seeing much residual nitrogen in our system. As I'm reducing nitrogen rates a little bit at a time, there's not the residual nitrogen for the following crop, if you like. So,
sure.
And I wonder if that's having a bearing on sort of second wheat aren't performing quite as well as they ever have done in the past, because there's not so much nitrogen left in the system for them. Whereas obviously after beans and stuff, after a legume, they're doing very well. We've bought all our fertilizer. We're sort of committed to growing wheat again. The wheat price still looks good. I can sell forward at decent prices, so we're fairly happy to keep going as we are. It's just meant the cash flow's squeezed hard, sort of thing.
Okay. And I suppose, given that, maybe the last question to you, and thanks very much for your time, but the last question, just in terms of, I suppose, in a time where cash flow isn't wonderful, there's probably a high risk in terms of, you know, trying to develop the farm and running out of cash in that scenario. In terms of some of the capital purchases that you might have been planning, you mentioned the drill that you might be updating that, but is there other things that are kind of gone on the longer finger because of the fact that it's just a trickier and more risky time at the moment?
I think we've got a few other income sources. We've got some residential and commercial lets. And we've got quite a big solar park here as well that feeds in. So we've got a few different income sources here. So I'm not saying they support farming, but they're all sort of support each other a little bit. And, you know, there's no doubt I've got, you know, one tractor that's, it's been a little bit troublesome and I would like to change, but I'm sort of thinking I could probably manage with it for another year or two. We'll just see, because the price of even used tractors is, they've doubled in price. I mean, literally, it's frightening now, the price of kit. The drill change is sort of cost neutral to us, actually, because that's not a huge expenditure. The FERT system is going to be the only real capital expenditure for us this year. But in terms of investing in the farm, we're fairly well. We had a big sort out. I've probably mentioned it in previous podcasts, and we run a very lean system. And I think our view is that we'll keep going with what we got. We don't need to invest particularly at the moment. All our kit's in good order. What we are investing in is perhaps more commercial units to let. I can see more, a sort of a more stable income, if you like. Farming's very volatile at the moment. I mean, the wheat price is up and down. Input prices are up and down. And actually, labour's getting more and more of an issue over here to get people to work on farms. So we're still committed to farming, but I think if in terms of any major investment, we'll probably stick that money in towards more commercial lets or something like that on the farm. So, we're doing a lot of tree planting and stuff this year. And it's another thing I'm looking at is whether we can monetize the trees a bit more and maybe grow a crop off the trees, nuts or fruit or something. So we're sort of looking at things like that, maybe slightly different to your standard growing crops farming, if you like.
I think we might come back to that maybe at another podcast, maybe hopefully for sure, maybe in the somewhere around October, November, because I think it's an interesting one, given the fact that I suppose UK agriculture is now in a very much a transition kind of phase away from direct subsidies, and I suppose you're really going to you're on your own type of scenario. So all these other sources of income are, I suppose, going to be critical to try and keep farms going, I suppose. So we might come back to that again, Andy, if you're okay to chat about it.
Yeah, it's quite, I mean, that's quite a big subject to try and cover there in one question. But yeah, you're right. I mean, times are really going to be hard. The government are not at all supportive of farmers or farming or the countryside, it seems. The new environmental schemes that they're bringing out, they just don't pay anything like the money. You know, and it's kind of reflected in that they, they set the money for the environmental schemes 12 months ago, and obviously things have shifted on quite considerably in terms of input costs and output costs. So they're way off the mark, and the trade deals that the British government are trying to do are crucifying farming as well. You know, they're not helping us.
I suppose it was never going to be pretty, but maybe it depends on which side of the fence you're sitting on. Maybe depends which side is pretty, I suppose. Maybe, but look, that's for another day. Andy, I'm really delighted you could give up a little bit of your time in the middle of harvest, maybe towards the end of harvest. But again, thanks very much for your time, and we'd be delighted if we could touch base with you again, maybe towards the back end of the year.
No problem, Michael. It's been a pleasure again.
That's brilliant. Thanks very much, Andy.
Okay. Cheers, then.
So that's it for this week, and my thanks to Andy for joining me again in the podcast. The Chagas Crop Forum is running again this year on Thursday, September the 8th in the Killeshi Hotel, Naas. The event will cover areas like the changes we can expect to CAP 2023 and the new acre scheme, but it will also concentrate on the high risks involved in producing crops for the 2023 harvest. Mark this event in your calendar, and I'm certainly looking forward to meeting you at the event. Finally, don't forget, if you enjoyed this podcast, then recommend it to a friend or colleague. And as always, rate, review and follow on Apple Podcasts or Spotify so you never miss an episode. And for more information, go to chagas.ie. I'm Michael Hennessy. Thanks for listening. And I'll be back next week with more tillage news and advice.